The data that I will present you today are of a project that an ongoing project that we have in collaboration with the unit of neurology of the Policlinico Tor Vergata in Rome on progressive supranuclear palsy and the use of fibroblast, primary patient-derived fibroblast, to model in vivo this disease. Progressive supranuclear palsy was first described by the Canadian neurologist Clifford Richardson in the early 60s. In 1963, Richardson, at the American Neurological Association, described a progressive degenerative cerebral disease that was not previously recognized. And in the same year, together with Olszewski and Steele, they published a report of six cases of an heterogeneous system degeneration. In the following year, the same author published a paper where they named this heterogeneous disease progressive supranuclear palsy, that is characterized by an heterogeneous degeneration involving the brain stem, the basal ganglia, and the cerebellum with vertical gaze, pseudobulbar palsy, and dementia. At the cellular level, they observed nerve cell loss and gliosis, neurofibrillary tangles, and glial nodules. Progressive supranuclear palsy is a tauopathy, a primary tauopathy, meaning that the tau is the primary pathological protein and is classified as 4R tauopathy. Later, you will understand what that means. Anyway, has different stages. It is believed to start in the subcortical areas like the putamen, the external and internal globus pallidum, and the substantia nigra. Then it moves rostrally and caudally to the cortical areas, the pontine and the cerebellum. At the end of the disease, practically all the brain is affected, except for the occipital area, the visual cortex. And that could be also interesting to understand why just this area. Anyhow, at the MRI images show a typical image named the hummingbird sign. You see here we have the body, the head, and the rostrum of the hummingbird. This is a typical MRI of a PSP patients. The classical PSP disease is the Richardson syndrome, but PSP has an important overlap with other neurodegenerative diseases, depending on the predominant pathological distribution, either cortical or in the brain stem, and has overlap with the corticobasal syndrome, the behavioral variant frontotemporal dementia, PSP Parkinsonism, and Parkinsonism dementia of the Guam pathology. So at first, it's difficult to diagnose PSP, and is a disease that goes under the big umbrella of the Parkinsonism. Tau is the main pathological protein. At the cellular level in PSP brains, tau aggregates in differently depending on the cellular type. In neurons, it aggregates as neurofibrillary tangles around the nucleus. In the astrocytes, has tufted aggregates. In the oligodendrocytes, has coiled or Cajal bodies. Tau. The microtubule associated protein tau is located on chromosome 17, spans 16 exons, and is present in two haplotypes, named H1 and H2. The start codon is on exon 1, the stop codon is on exon 13. In the CNS, exon 2, 3, and 10 are alternatively spliced, and this alternative splicing generates six different isoforms, depending on the absence, 0N, the presence of 1, 1N, or 2, 2N amino terminal inserts, together in combination with 3 or 4 microtubule binding repeats. Here is 3R, 4R. PSP is classified as a 4R tauopathy. It's also present a bigger protein named Big Tau. The full protein, the 2N4R, is made of 441 amino acids, has the two N-terminal regions, a proline-rich region, a microtubule binding region, and the C-terminal. Tau is known to undergo a number of post-translational modifications like sumoiliation, truncation, glycation, and is a good substrate for protein kinases. It contains 45 serine, 35 threonine, and 5 tyrosines with phosphate acceptor residues. In general, a hyperphosphorylated tau is a pathological tau. Tau is known as a microtubule regulating protein. In the neurons, is linked to the microtubules and stabilizes the microtubule, promotes microtubule assembly, and regulates axonal transport. But now we know that it is also present in the nucleus, where it contributes to integrity of genomic DNA and nuclear RNA, and regulates heterochromatin stability. Is present also in the dendrites, where is involved in synaptic plasticity and regulates the NMDA and AMPA receptors. NMDA and AMPA receptors are the main receptors of the glutamatergic system, the excitatory system of the neuron of the brain. At the synaptic terminals, interact with F-actin and is involved in vesicles turnover. As I said, hyperphosphorylated tau is a pathological tau. Why? Because hyperphosphorylation leads to the deattachment of tau from the microtubules, and this render the microtubule more labile, and also leads to the formation of tau aggregates within the cytosol. PSP is a primary tauopathy, meaning that tau is the primary pathological protein, like a number of other neuropathological diseases like corticobasal degeneration of PIC disease. But in other diseases, It interacts, co-works with other pathological proteins like alpha-synuclein in Parkinson's disease or dementia with Lewy bodies, with beta-amyloid in Alzheimer's disease or vascular dementia, in prion diseases, and in other diseases like Huntington disease or the Parkinsonism dementia of Guam. We decided to work with fibroblasts because they are a peripheral tissue that is easy to obtain, although less easy than white blood cells, but not susceptible to immunoresponse for obvious reasons. And also they can be grown in dish and they make cellular contact like neurons. So we opted for fibroblasts. And in collaboration with Nicola Mercuri and Tommaso Schirinzi at the Unit of Neurology of the Policlinico Tor Vergata, we have obtained this cohort of patients, seven patients. This is number eight because unfortunately we lost number seven. And when you work with the patient's derived cell, that is really a tragedy, I must say, because it's important. And all in the study have been included only patients with the Richardson syndrome type of PSP following the Movement Disorder Society indications. And all of the patients have supportive imaging biomarkers. The skin biopsies are obtained, are taken from the upper arm of the subject. They are mechanically dissected and seeded in a dish. This is a phase contrast image. Here is the skin fibroblast, the keratinocyte, the skin biopsy, sorry, the keratinocyte, and then the fibroblasts that are literally migrating outside the skin biopsy. And they show, they have their typical bindle-like morphology. Usually, the first passages, the first three passages are collected and stored. And all the experiments that I'm presenting you today are made with fibroblasts between the fourth and the eighth passage. After the eighth passage, we discard the fibrils because they became too old. So one challenge in studying the human fibroblast is also to obtain all of them at the same passage, at the same time, to be able to analyze them. And this could be a challenge. Anyway, firstly, we analyzed the expression of the 3R and 4R isoforms by assessing the splicing of exon 10. And in general, we have observed in our PSP cohort an increase in the 4R isoform, meaning that they are a 4R type of tauopathy. Then, as I said, an hyperphosphorylated tau is a pathological tau. So we assessed in our cohort tau tau phosphorylation using the phosphotag acrylamide gels. These are gels that allow the separation of protein depending on their phosphorylation. And here is the Western blot showing an increased phosphorylation of tau in surely in PSP 2, 4, 6, and 8, but also in PSP 5, and a bit of phosphorylation in 2, less clear in 1. But in general, we have a cohort with an increased tau phosphorylation, meaning that we have a pathological tau. One thing that I want to say, this is my first work with human patients. Working with mice is in a way much easier because they are more, we have a lot of diversity within our cohort. So for a while we discussed in the lab what should we do. We consider each patient or we consider the whole group. At the end, I think we have decided to consider the whole group because if there is a feature that is typical of the disease, although the high variability, it should come out. We should see it. So we decided to treat the PSP cohort as a whole. Then we analyzed the expression of tau. I must remind that we are looking at endogenous tau in fibroblasts, not in neuronal cells. So it's also this is a kind of a challenge. Anyway, we didn't measure any statistically significant increase in tau protein in our cohort. As you can see, there is no difference between the control group and the PSP group. What we observed was an increase in localization, in the cytosolic localization of tau, a change, not a change, a modification in the cytosolic localization of tau with an increase in tau aggregation that in our fibrous is like a sand-like immunostaining, meaning that we have an increase in small tau aggregates. Here and here we used the same antibody, tau5, that usually, as all the other have reported, is recognizing cytosolic tau, not nuclear tau. While growing the fibrous, we observed an important, difference in their shape. This is the same enlargement. So you can see the huge difference in shape between controls and PSP. While the controls have their typical shape in like spindle-like, the PSP look like more a fried egg. They are expanded. And we measured the cell size around the nucleus and observed an increase in the cell size in the PSP fibrous compared to the controls. And again, while growing the fibrous, we observed a difference in their proliferation rate. So we decided to quantify the number of cells in a time course. We plated the same number of cells and then count them with the Corning cell counter at 24, 48, and 96 hours. And as you can see, we have an increase, a decreased cell proliferation in our PSP cohort. The decrease in cell proliferation could be also due to an increased mortality. So we checked if the cell viability of our population using the MTT assay that is based on the reduction of yellow MTT to purple for Masania by the mitochondrial dehydrogenase. And at 48 hours, we observed an increase in cell viability, meaning that there is no cell death, but also that there is an increased mitochondrial activity in our samples. And I will return to this data later in my talk. Because of this decreased cell proliferation, we decided to analyze the cell cycle steps of our fibrils. As you may know, the cell cycle is divided in G1, S, G2, and M. And by tropidium iodide and BRDU incorporation and FACS analysis, we can assess the percentage of cells in the different phases of the cell cycle, G1, S, G2. This is a typical three-dimensional FACS analysis of a control. This is a typical FACS analysis of a PSP patients. Here are the cumulative results. And as you can see, in the PSP population, we have an increased number of cells in the G1 stage. It seems that the PSP population is stuck somehow in the G1 phase. This data is also confirmed with the P1 incorporation. P1 is a cycling-dependent inhibitor, and it inhibits the transition in the cell cycle between G1S or G2M. It inhibits the transition between interphases. A decrease in P1, together with this increase in G1, is suggestive of a cell cycle stuck in the G1 phase. As I said, the MTT data is also a measure of the mitochondrial activity. And mitochondria in lately have been heavily studied in neurodegenerative diseases. So, we have also observed an increase in mitochondrial parameters in white blood cells from PSP patients and also from Parkinsonians. So, we measured the mitochondrial bioenergetic parameters in our PSP cohort and found an increase in several parameters, including basal respiration, maximal respiration, ATP production, and spare respiratory capacity. Somehow, this is opposite of one main thing, a diseased protein cell probably has a malfunctioning mitochondria, not an hyperfunctioning mitochondria. We explain this by if we think of a cell that is in a stressful condition, we may also think that this cell is trying to cope with this stressful condition by, for example, producing more ATP or trying to have the mitochondria functioning as much as possible to cope with a situation that is leading to a malfunctioning cell. And lately, not just in PSP, but as I said, in Parkinson's disease and also in ALS, several other groups have observed an increase in the mitochondrial parameters, not what we should expect a decrease. So it seems a more functioning mitos, but a more functioning mitos, it indicates an over-functioning mitochondrial chain. So maybe an overproduction of mitochondrial oxygen species. So we checked if that was the case, and indeed it is. In our population, we have an increase in mitochondrial reactive oxygen species that in the end can lead to a malfunctioning mitochondria. As you can see, as I already point out, we have a strong variability in our population. And this is one of the main problems that I'm learning while working with human cells, that is a problem because we want to have all this point all together and this and that. But with the human cells, that is not the case. So again, if something comes out, that should be a feature of the disease, we hope. Okay. We also measured an increase in mitochondrial DNA copy number. This is something that we want to explore further because an increase in mitochondrial activity could also mean an increase in mitochondria, but we should understand, see, check how these mitochondria are, how many. How is the shape of the mitochondria? But anyway, we have an increased number of mitochondria in our population. These are cells in pathological cells. So we may think cells in a stressful condition. And several reports, not in PSP, but in other tauopathies, have reported that tau interact with stress granules. So we wanted to see whether also in our population, our endogenous tau interact with stress granules and whether there is an increase in stress granules in our fibrous. Several reports have published that there is a very well described interaction of tau with the TR1. And we observed this same increase interaction in our tau population, but we doubt a clear increase in TR1 in intensity. While we observed an increase in another stress granulus marker, G3BP1, and an increase in interaction of tau with G3BP1. We are currently doing proximity ligation assay to confirm this data, because this is the person's coefficient gives an idea, but PLA should be the real deal, I would say. And we are currently doing this. But anyway, we have an increase in stress granules in our fibrils. Okay, here is something that we have observed in these just a few days. The dogma of tau is that is a microtubule stabilizer. Although in the last few years this dogma has been challenged. The microtubules have a stable domain and a labile domain. Tau seems to be more present in the labile domain. An hyperphosphorylated tau deattaches from the microtubules, freeing the slot in the labile domain to real stabilizers of microtubules to attach to the labile domain, leading to a more stable labile domain, leading to an alteration of the degree of stable and labile domain within the cell. Tau-depleted microtubules are highly detyrosinated, so we checked the degree of tyrosination in our samples and found a decrease in tyrosinated tubulin, suggestive of something similar to this hypothesis. So, the attachment of tau from the labile domain and an imbalance in our fibrils between the two domains, the stable and the labile domain. Finally, we have performed a label-free proteomic characterization of three controls and five PSPs. And as you can see, we have a clear clustering in the heat map of the controls and the PSP samples, and the fold enrichment shows a clear enrichment in the metabolic pathways, reminder of the mitochondrial activity. So, in conclusion, we have a cellular model of PSP that shows an increased tau phosphorylation, a slower cell cycle, a mitochondrial hyperactivity, and an increased cytosolic stress granus, All of these characteristics have been described in the PSP pathology. So we have a good model, a good cellular model of PSP. And in conclusion, as you may have guessed, we have collected fibrils to obtain pluripotent cells and in the end brain-derived cells from patients' fibrils. This is the final goal. And as Emanuele said, I've been working for years also on ALS. So this is our small repository of controls, four controls, seven PSPs, and eight. And eight ALS. Again, we had a dramatic few months where we lost one PSP and one ALS because of problems in the cell culture. So this was. But anyway, as of now, we have two good fully characterized clones from a control and three fully characterized clones from a PSP. With the ALS, we are having some problems because the cardiogenic characterization didn't go well, but we are starting all over again and we hope to obtain good PSPs. And I want to thank my collaborators for the data that I'm presenting you today, that I presented you in particular, Francesca Ciaiola and Juliette Jimenez, and Roberta De Mori, the head of the Stem Cell Facility at the Fondazione Santa Lucia, and you for your attention.